All right, so what we've seen so far, today is going to be our last discussion on what happens when an angular momentum, for example, a spin half object is placed inside a sterling magnetic field, and how does Schrodinger equation manifest itself. We've already started this discussion in the previous two lectures. Today we're going to make one, today is a grand finale in the sense that I'm going to present a complete NMR experiment and will connect between the quantum picture and the engineering approach as to how the NMR is actually built and how it works. So what we've seen so far is that when a spin half object is placed inside a magnetic field, one can write a Hamiltonian H, which is omega naught SG, right? Where omega naught is a Lambda frequency. Omega naught is given by minus gamma B naught. It's a uniform magnetic field pointing along the Z direction. It's a homogeneous field. Gamma is a gyromagnetic ratio. We want omega naught to be positive. Omega naught is positive when gamma is negative. And gamma was defined as some Lambda G factor charge mass of the proton. So the charge on the proton and the value of G is chosen such that gamma turns out to be negative so that we get positive omega naught. Alright, so this is where we started off from. This Hamiltonian admits two eigenstates. One of the eigenstates we called alpha, the other eigenstate we call beta. So it's a two-dimensional Hilbert space spanned by these basis states. The energies that are measured in this basis given by omega naught multiplied by the eigenvalues of SG, and they are plus minus h bar over 2, where the plus corresponds to the state half, that is the value of ms is plus half. We call the state alpha, and the minus corresponding to the state beta. So if you want to draw an energy level diagram, we have these two states. Since omega naught is positive, the lower energy state is the ket beta state. So I put ket beta here and I put ket alpha here. This energy is minus h bar omega naught over 2, and this energy is plus h bar omega naught over 2, and this spacing is h bar omega naught. Alright? And we also discussed that since it's a two-level quantum system, it's a qubit, everything can be represented on a Bloch sphere, where the north pole represents ket alpha and the south pole represents ket beta. And ket beta in our convention, in our definition, is the ground state. Okay, because it's the lowest energy state. Agreed? Alright. So this was one aspect that we started off with. This is setting up the system. The second aspect that we discussed was that if you can have precession, what precession means is that if you consider the blocks here, and you start off in a state that lies on the equatorial plane. For example, you start off with the state ket alpha plus ket beta under root 2. Okay. And this is the Hamiltonian, because still the spins are inside a magnetic field that's pointing in the direction. Then what happens is that this quantum state is going to precess in the equatorial plane, right? So if this is the quantum state at some instant, other instance, the quantum state is just going to rotate or precess And the precessional frequency we learned is omega naught, which is equal to the energy spacing in this energy level diagram. This omega naught also, remember, depends upon the magnetic field. Higher the magnetic field, higher would be the precessional frequency. And this behavior we derived by solving the Schrödinger equation. Okay? So this is another, this is the second important aspect that we learned in the previous class. Another aspect that we've learned is rapid flow. Okay. So rapid flow meant that if our initial state was at alpha, right? And we apply a magnetic field, which in this case points on the y direction. So the magnetic field points along the y direction, so our Hamiltonian, let's call it H1, is some omega 1 s y, right? Because the magnetic field, even though it's a uniform homogeneous field, now it's pointing on the y direction. Then this magnetic field can cause this quantum state to turn towards the equatorial plane, and it will do so with a certain frequency, right? So it's going to come down to the certain frequency. It will go to ket beta, and it will make oscillations between ket alpha and ket beta. So these oscillations are called Rabi oscillations. And you can find out the probability of finding ket alpha after time t, the probability of finding ket beta after time t, and so on. So this Hamiltonian, which would cause a unitary operation given by E raised to minus iota omega 1 p s y over h bar, is nothing but a rotation about the y axis, right? It's a rotation operator. So now if we would like to make the rotation operator physically, what we do is we apply a magnetic field. Previously we learned what a rotation operator generically means. Now we've learned how to physically implement, what's the possibility of physically implementing a rotation operator? Through the action of a constant magnetic field pointing in a certain direction. So this operator, which is really a rotation about the y-axis through some angle, and what is this angle? What's this angle? Omega. It's omega 1 t. So the angle changes with time. This kind of motion is called Rabi flipping or Rabi flopping. So these are the different phenomena that we studied in our previous lecture. Any question? Because this is our starting line for today's lecture.
So what is the difference between Rabi flipping and precession?
And?
Precession. We just have a tilted phase of Rabi.
There is really no difference. The only point is what we become apparent now is that this precession is always taking place for this Rabi flopping. Are transitions between these energy levels which are affected by the application of external perturbation. This is can also be considered to be a Rabi flopping. I mean, they're equivalent. But when this field is always on, this field is a controlled field that you apply, then the action of oscillation under the pretext of these controlled fields, they are called Rabi flopping. So, but you're right, this precession is also Rabi flopping. It's Rabi flopping between ket alpha plus beta over root 2 and ket alpha minus beta over root 2. It's just the same thing. But you will learn in a minute that this field is always on and this field is a control field that you can switch on and off.
Can you say the Rabi flopping is basically the section between two
high-density? No. It could be oscillations or precession through any two states. I mean, these are equivalent, right? You just turn the Bloch sphere, you will get, these are identical behaviors, but I would like to emphasize the difference between them for a reason. And the reason we'll explore just now, okay? Now what I would like to tell you about is a complete NMR experiment, all right. So suppose we have a test tube. Now this test tube contains water in its liquid form. Now water is just molecules of H2O, two protons per molecule. So each proton is a spin half particle. Now I would like to place this test tube inside strong magnetic field. I define my axis such that this is the z-axis, x-axis is out of the plane and y is towards the right. I would like to apply a uniform magnetic field in the z-direction. So the best way I could do that is through a solenoid, through an electromagnet. So what I have, I would like to place this test tube inside a solenoid. The solenoid, of course, should carry a current. So if the field is to be pointing vertically upward, what's the direction of the current? Right? It has to come out of these coils and go in here, right? The right hand rule, okay? So the current is coming out of these coils and is going into the plane of the paper here. So this will create a magnetic field in the upper direction. And if this coil is very large as compared to the size of the test tube, it's going to be a very uniform field. In fact, NMR manufacturers go to extra lengths at making this field uniform and homogeneous. Okay. So if you would like to create a large field, and if, which means you would like to have a large current, because you know this relationship, the magnetic field is equal to mu naught Ni, right? One Tesla would require a very large current because this factor is really small, 4 pi to 10 to minus 7 Weber per meter per ampere. You need a very large current. Your coils will heat up because there is I square heating losses inside the coil, where R is the resistance of the coil. I know it is. ठीक है अब ये देखो ये resistive heating नहीं होने हम नहीं चाहते resistive heating. So I'm telling you, make these coils out of a material that has no resistance. Can you think of such a material? Can we have a material which doesn't have any resistance?
Superconductor.
Yes, we can have a superconductor which has really zero resistance. Right? So we make this coil out of a superconducting material like some alloy of niobium and tin. Okay? But the problem is that this material superconducts only at very low temperature. So you want to put this coil inside liquid helium. So you place this coil inside a thermos or a dewar of liquid helium. The temperature of boiling liquid helium is 4 kelvins. So this temperature is about 4 kelvins. Once you connect a power supply to this solenoid, you can turn out the power supply and the current will fall. It will continue to persist till probably the day of judgment. If these coils remain cold enough. Okay? If the helium is there, the current will continue to flow. It will persistently flow without any power supply, without any battery, because there is no resistance. Okay, this is what a superconductor is. And you can only explain superconductivity through quantum mechanics, by the way. Alright, so this is liquid helium at 4 Kelvin. But
is it hairan or
hairan? Hairan, pareshan,
iskandar,
hairan,
what is it? If supply off, then it will be
current. This is superconductor. Achha, ab dekhen, you're at room temperature. Your NMR magnet is at room temperature, but now you have a thermos which is at 4 Kelvin. This is a huge temperature gradient from room to helium. So you would like to put everything, you would like to enshroud it in another jacket of probably liquid helium, which is at 77 kelvins, so that the temperature gradient from the room is smaller. So you put everything inside an additional jacket of liquid nitrogen. So this is liquid nitrogen, and here you have liquid helium, and a persistent current. So now if I would like to plot versus time, the magnetic field along the z direction, it's always on. It never fades away. So B naught along the z direction is always on. It's always operative. So these fins inside the test tube are always seeing the Hamiltonian H naught, right? Which is omega naught SD. This is the background Hamiltonian that is never off. Okay? So depending upon the state of the spins can precess. The spins will always precess if they are not in an eigenstate of LZ. If they are in an eigenstate of LZ, they will of course not precess because these are stationary states of LZ. So this Hamiltonian H naught is always on. The spins always see this Hamiltonian. Okay? So they will always respond to this Hamiltonian if they are not in a stationary state. G is a B. क्यों करें ताकि ये 77 केल्विन हो ये 4 केल्विन हो ताकि ग्रेडिएंट आसान हो वरना आपको बहुत ऐसा मटेरियल चाहिए जो थर्मल स्ट्रेसेस को इतने टेंपरेचर ग्रेडिएंट को शॉर्ट डिस्टेंस में विदस्टैंड कर सके ऐसे मटेरियल्स मिलना बहुत मुश्किल लगे जिसके एक एंड में 4 केल्विन हो एक एंड में 298 केल्विन हो और फिर भी वो मटेरियल फ्रैक्चर ना करे ठीक है सो यू वुड लाइक टू मेक द ट्रांजिशन द टेंपरेचर ट्रांजिशन स्मूथ ऑलराइट So the spins will precess under the action of this Hamiltonian if they are not in a stationary state. Now what we would like to do, we would like to place a coil that is at room temperature and whose axis is along the x-axis. This is something that we've already seen. So I place a coil here, a solenoid perhaps, okay, that is oriented along the x-axis, so it's out of the plane of the black hole. Okay, so this is the x-axis. And it's placed as close as possible to the test tube. But it's at room temperature. It's not a superconductor. This coil is not a superconductor. It's a normal conductor. Alright. Now what I would like to do, I would like to, in fact what happens in NMR experiments is that you apply a pulse. Suppose I apply suppose I pass a current through this coil. I transmit a current and the current is not steady. It's an AC current. Which means that it will produce of course a magnetic field that's pointing along the x direction. Right? So my magnetic field that I apply, this is not, is beyond my control, B naught is beyond my control, it's a uniform field, but I apply a pulse of current that is perhaps looks like a cosinusoid and then I switch it off. Okay? Now this produces a magnetic field. Suppose the amplitude of this field is B1, right?
Coil
field is magnetic. Coil field is magnetic. Coil field is magnetic. So this magnetic field has an amplitude B1. Remember that this omega naught is related to B0. Higher this field, higher will be this Larmor frequency. If this is 1 Tesla, this frequency is 42 megahertz. We're talking about photons. Now this B1, why can you have large fields for B1? Because it's a superconductor. You can afford to have a current of say loads and loads of current through it. You can have hundreds of amperes of current without any heating of the photon. So you can produce large magnetic fields in this manner. However, you cannot produce large magnetic fields in this normal superconducting coil. It's a feeble coil that is placed as close as possible to the sun. So this is a very small field. If this is of the order of a Tesla, this could be of the order of a mini Tesla. Right? Typically. So it's three orders of magnitude smaller than this field. Now, this field is pointing in a certain direction. That direction is the x direction, because the field is parallel to the axis of the coil. So if I would like to write an equation for B1, B1 is a vector, right? It's a magnetic field, it's a vector. It depends upon time. I can write B1 cosine. Now this field, this oscillatory field, will have a certain frequency. Okay? The frequency at which it oscillates. What I would like to do, I would like to keep this frequency the same as this Lamo frequency. And I'll later tell you why this is so, because this is the phenomenon of resonance. The R in NMR stands for resonance. So I would like to apply an external field, a pulse, that has the same frequency as the Lamo frequency of the spin. This frequency is determined by this field. Okay? And I put time here. And of course, this pulse can have a phase as well. I can apply a sine wave, I can apply a cosine wave, I can apply any wave I like. So I would like to put, I can put a phase here as well, phi p. So I would like to pass a sinusoidal current through it. The current will have the same form as this. It will produce a magnetic field, which is given by this formula, approximately, with some scaling factors. Right? So how do I produce such? I have a computer, a PC, and I tell it, okay, I want a frequency, I want to generate a pulse of frequency omega naught and phase phi p. Okay. I put it inside a computer program. Computers deal with digital data, but I would like to output an analog waveform. So I have a digital to analog converter, which produces a wave. Okay. This current is amplified, okay, and then it goes to the coil. Alright? But this coil is practically an inductor. Okay? So what I would like to do, I would like to transfer maximum power to this coil. So if I put a capacitor in series with this coil, and the L is the inductance of the coil, I know that this circuit, which is called a tank circuit, has a resonance frequency. I adjust this capacitance such that the resonance frequency equals omega naught. That omega naught equals 1 over LC under. My pulse is coming in with the frequency omega naught. Right? Omega naught. I would like all of the power to go into this coil. So I make this a resonant circuit, so that all the power can be transferred to this coil, and hence all the power can go to the spins, the quantum mechanical objects that I am dealing with. Now this is the interface between quantum mechanics and practical reality. This is how you talk to quantum entities. Okay. Now if this is the oscillatory magnetic field, which is on for a time, it turns on and then turns off. Suppose the time for which this pulse is on is called TP, the pulse time. Okay? So when the pulse is off, this field is always on. It remains on. But the pulse goes on and off. The pulse goes on and off. Okay? You can adjust B1, how strong the pulse you would like to apply, you can adjust the pulse width as well. Okay? In the simplest cases, you would like to keep the frequency omega naught the same as this frequency. Now, can you please write the Hamiltonian for this magnetic field? If this is your magnetic field, what Hamiltonian does it correspond to? H1 the Hamiltonian corresponding to the pulse is given by, dekho, some frequency. The frequency is minus gamma B naught. So I put minus gamma B1 here, okay, into the spin operator. I would also like to put this factor. So I put minus gamma B1 cosine omega naught P plus phi P. And what spin factor, what spin angular momentum operator should I write? Sx. Because my field is along the x-axis. So now I have the Hamiltonian that depends upon time. Alright? Now I would like to call this factor omega 1. Okay? Some other frequency. If this omega 1 is 3 orders of magnitude smaller than omega naught, because B1 is 3 orders of magnitude smaller. So if omega naught is of the order of millihertz, this is of the order of perhaps, bolo, agar wo megahertz mein hai omega 1, omega naught, to ye omega 1 kitne hai? Kilohertz mein. So if these are RF frequencies, right? This is an RF frequency, megahertz. Mobile phone operates at 100 megahertz, right? So these frequencies, this omega 1 is probably at kilohertz. So this is an audio frequency. Okay? So H1 equals omega 1 cosine omega naught P plus phi P Sx. Alright, now something really interesting I would like to share. If I draw the block sphere from the top, if this is my x-axis, and if I look at this field, remember this is along the x-axis, ya main x unit vector dalna bhool gaya tha, theek hai, yahan pe x unit vector bhi hai. So the field is always along the x-axis, but it's positive and negative, right? So if I look from the top, the field is positive and maximum. Then the field decreases, then it decreases. So it decreases sinusoidally, changes direction, increases in the opposite direction. So this is how the field is varying. Can you imagine this? So if I look from the top, the field is maximum, then it decreases, diminishes sinusoidally, becomes zero, and then it increases in the opposite direction. So the field is reciprocating, okay? It's changing linearly. It always remains along the x-axis. In other words, I can say that the field is linearly polarized. It's a linearly polarized magnetic field. Okay? It always remains parallel to the x-axis. Now I can decompose this motion into two different circular motions, which means that if I can also visualize that this reciprocating field, this oscillatory field, is a combination of two counter rotating components. I can say that I have a component that is going around at a frequency plus omega naught, right? Which means when I view from the top in the anti-clockwise direction, plus a field that is going around in the clockwise direction, but the same frequency, the same magnitude. So a frequency component of minus omega naught. Okay? So I can decompose this reciprocatory motion of the magnetic field. This reciprocatory variation of the magnetic field into two counter-rotating components. If I add this vector with this vector, the resultant of these two vectors will give me this variation of the vector. Agree? Alright. Now equipped with this knowledge, equipped with this knowledge, I would like to decompose this Hamiltonian into, or I would like to, I could also like to decompose this magnetic field. I can also always decompose this magnetic field in the following fashion. I can write B1 over 2 cosine omega naught t plus phi t x plus B1 over 2 sine omega naught t plus phi t y, right? Now this is the component that is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay? These two terms represent this figure. Alright? Plus, I also have to subtract this. So I put plus B1 over 2 cosine omega naught t plus phi t x minus B1 over 2 sine omega naught t plus phi t, right? Agreed? I can always decompose B1 as a sum of four components. Now, what I've written here, these two terms represent this vector that is rotating with the frequency of plus omega naught, and these bottom two terms represent the counter rotating component that is rotating with the frequency of minus omega naught. Okay? This is very simple. Now the point is that if you would like to talk about resonance, this component is at a frequency plus omega naught. This is at a frequency of minus omega naught. And the Lamo frequency of the spin is plus omega naught. So the components that are in the yellow box, they are resonant with the spins. Okay? So what I've written in the yellow box is resonant with the spins, because the frequency of this stimulus is the same as the natural frequency of the system in the omega naught. Okay? However, what I've written in the pink box has a frequency minus omega naught, whereas the system has a frequency of plus omega naught. So it's far apart from the natural frequency. It's at a difference of 2 omega naught. So this is the non-resonant component. And if we were to talk about NMR, which is nuclear magnetic resonance, I need to only consider the resonant component. This non-resonant component will play a very insignificant role. Now what I've said here, I've actually bypassed a large portion of literature, okay? And it's not possible for me to actually prove this to you. But the upshot is that if we were to apply a stimulus that is off-resonant with the natural frequency of the system, then that stimulus will not nudge the system. So this frequency component, which is far off from the natural frequency, will not affect the system, or it will minimally affect the system. So we can ignore this. Okay? Now our field. We just need to consider this component of the field, which is rotating at the same frequency as the Lamo frequency of the spins. So if you consider what I've written in the yellow box, H1 becomes equal to minus a plus omega 1 over 2, right? Because omega 1 is defined as minus gamma B1. So I have a B1 over 2 factor here. Half of the energy of the pulse is going into the non-resonant component. And it's going wasted. It's wasted. So only half of the energy is there. So I have minus gamma B1 over 2. I define minus gamma B1 as omega 1. I'm left with the omega 1 over 2 here, and cosine omega naught p plus phi p sx plus sine omega naught p plus phi p S1, right? So this is my H1. Agree? Now for repetition, my H0, which is independent of time, is simply omega naught Sz. This is in megahertz typically, this is in kilohertz. Now suppose the initial state of the system is alpha. Right? Suppose this is my initial state. I would like to see how the state changes with time. During the application of the pulse, somewhere between 0 and tp, what is the state? So I now have the total Hamiltonian. The total Hamiltonian is H0 plus H1, which is a function of time. Right? So it's the sum of these Hamiltonians. From the Schrodinger equation, I would like to find out what the new quantum state is going to be. It's going to be exponent minus iota. I'm not writing e just for minus iota because that might confuse you. So I'm writing exponent. Okay? Exponent minus iota into the total Hamiltonian. Now the total Hamiltonian is omega naught Sz t over h bar, right, plus omega 1 h1, h1 is this, omega 1 over 2 अच्छा अब ये हमें तो नहीं लिखना तो cosine omega naught t plus pi t Sx over h bar t plus sine omega naught t plus pi t s by over h bar t, and all of this is acting on the state capital. See if this makes sense. I've just exponentiated the total Hamiltonian.
Sy. All three operators don't mutually commute. So I cannot factorize, I cannot
think that, okay, let's find out the action of SZ operator, then find out the action of SX operator, then find out the action of SY operator. I cannot break up this concatenation into three successive operations, because all three operations are acting together. I cannot have my little heart desire that, okay, let's first see how the state evolves under the action of SZ, then let's see how it evolves under SX, then see how it evolves under SY. I can't do that. All three operators are acting in tandem. Okay? So I can, it seems to be calculationally impossible, or very difficult at least, to find out the new quantum state. So I need to resort to something else. Okay? Do you understand the problem that we hit a solid wall? We would like to cross this wall.
So we take it where it is linear.
AK exponent mein ye teen operators hai, saath shamil ke sam shamil hai,
so jaise agar wo coil na ho x mein
tab to humne kiya na precession hogi, ye koi karni hogi tab to aasan hai wo precession kuch nahi
to sir mein sa z mein hai x mein lagne wala hai which is the
ke bhi wo cheez nahi hai If I have a quantum state psi, I do a rotation about y, right? R y, okay? 2 theta 1. Then I do an operation about x, 2 theta 2. Is this equal to R x theta 2? This operation preceding the other operation? Are these two equal? No, they're not, because this operator doesn't commute to this operator. So I cannot arbitrarily adjust the orders of my operators. I can only do that if those operators commute. And if I'm exponentiating Hamiltonians, only the Hamiltonians commute. But here these Hamiltonians don't commute. This operator doesn't commute with this operator. It doesn't commute with this operator. So I cannot break up this exponent of the sum of operators into the product of exponents of operators. I can't do that. Okay? So what do I do? I resort to something very interesting. I resort to an approximation that is called the rotating wave approximation. In quantum mechanics. Alright, now listen extremely carefully. Suppose this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis, and the z-axis is pointing out of the plane of the paper. For example, this could be the Bloch sphere. And I have a quantum state psi as a function of t that is going around in this circle with the frequency omega naught. Okay? Agreed? So, suppose my state at time 0 is psi 0. Do I know what my state at time t is going to be? Can I relate the state at time 0 to the state at time 0 at some later time? What should I write here? E is for minus iota. What's the phase? Omega naught t. Omega naught t. And what's the operator? Sz, because my rotation is about the z axis. So Sz over h bar. Right? So my state at some later time t equals the action of this operator, this rotation about the z-axis through a phase omega naught t acting on the initial state. Now suppose I'm intelligent in the sense that my observer is rotating with the state, with the same frequency. So if I'm standing akimbo and I'm standing, I'm fixated in the lab frame, I can see the state to rotate. But if I'm rotating with the state, I'm in a rotating frame. And if I'm in a rotating frame, I can actually see, I can actually say that the state frame changed. So if I move to rotating frames, the state that appears to me might be different. Even though both of these states represent the same physical state. But I'm looking at this state in a rotating basis. So if my state in the rotating frame is denoted by this, the tilde sign, if the same state, the yellow vector, seen in a rotating frame, this will appear to be equal to this state at time 0, right? Because I'm rotating with the state. Agree? Hence, if I would like to connect this rotating frame state with the state in the lab frame, I would like to put an e raised to the plus iota omega naught t as z h1. ये बात ठीक है?
ये साइड टेल में ये ऑब्जर्वर का स्टेट
ये दिस इज द स्टेट ऑब्जर्व बाय एन ऑब्जर्वर हु इज रोटेटिंग विद द स्टेट इन सिंक्रोनी विद द स्टेट विद द सेम फ्रीक्वेंसी ही वुड सी द स्टेट अनचेंज्ड इफ यू जस्ट प्लग इन दिस वैल्यू फॉर साइड डी इनटू हियर यू विल गेट साइड एट टाइम 0 सो द स्टेट विल अपीयर अनचेंज्ड to an observer who is rotating with the state. ठीक है? एक हमारे गांव में मैरी गो राउंड होते हैं घोड़े जिनको कहते हैं जो बच्चा झूमते हैं अब खाली खड़े होकर देखें तो बच्चा आपको झूमता नजर आएगा लेकिन आप बच्चे के साथ साथ भागेंगे तो आप वो बच्चा स्टैटिक नजर आएगा ठीक है सो इन अ रोटेटिंग फ्रेम द स्टेट अपीयर्स स्टेशनरी ओके एंड दिस इज द ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन बिटवीन द रोटेटिंग एंड द नॉन रोटेटिंग फ्रेम्स ओके Now the Schrödinger equation is something physical. It should not depend upon what frame you would observe it. Right? So generally we know that the Schrödinger equation is given by d by dt into iota h bar psi t equals the Hamiltonian psi t. Okay? But everything should remain unchanged if we are observing the state in a rotating frame. So if I put a tilde here, I can put a tilde here, and now the Hamiltonian is a new Hamiltonian, which corresponds to the old Hamiltonian, but in the rotating frame. Okay. So I would like to perform a transformation of this Hamiltonian, h0 plus h1, so that all the time dependence goes away. I would like to do this somehow. Let's see how I can do that. But first of all, see, I would like to calculate what is the if I know the Hamiltonian in the non-rotating frame, I would like to calculate a Hamiltonian in a rotating frame. ठीक है, मैं चाहता हूँ कि I would like to find H, which is the Hamiltonian in the rotating frame, right? This is my goal. मैं ये करना चाहता हूँ. ताकि मैं अपने हैमिल्टोनियन को सिंप्लीफाई कर सकूं, मैं आगे चल सकूं. अभी मैं बिल्कुल रुक गया हूं. मेरे सामने एक ऐसी दीवार आ गई है जिसके सामने बार बार देखना मुश्किल हो रहा है मुझे. मैं एक मैथमेटिकल ट्रिक चलाना चाह रहा हूं, टूल इस्तेमाल करना चाह रहा हूं, क्वांटम मैकेनिक्स का बहुत इस्तेमाल. ठीक है, और अगला होमवर्क भी इसी तरह की चीज़ होंगे. इसलिए आपको थोड़ा सा सबर करना पड़ेगा, थोड़ा सा लेंथी कैलकुलेशन. अच्छा, आप देखें, लेट्स लुक एट द लेफ्ट हैंड साइड. Do you agree with me that this is the Schrödinger equation? I'm reading a new rotating frame, it's still the Schrödinger equation. There's no harm in writing this form of the Schrödinger equation. So if I take the left hand side, iota h bar d by dt of the wave function in the rotating frame which is given by this. E plus I omega naught t s z over h bar sin t. Right? I would like to find the derivative of this. So iota h bar, ye jhum kar kyun aa gaya, So this is a product of two time dependent function. I first take the derivative of this operator. It's iota omega naught s z over h bar e I omega naught t s z over h bar acting on psi d, right? Now I would like to take the derivative of this wave function, of this quantum state, plus e I omega naught t s z over h bar d by dt of psi d. क्या ये बात ठीक है? मैंने सिर्फ product लूँ, तो शायद इसको product नहीं कहते हैं। The derivative of product of two objects is, this is what I've applied here, okay? All right. Now, this factor, the derivative of the wave function in the unrotated frame, I can find this out from the Schrödinger equation, right? What is written in blue, this thing, is simply equal to, if you notice, this is equal to 1 over iota h bar, the Hamiltonian in the non-rotating frame, right? This is just a Schrödinger equation. कि मैं आपको आधा मिनट देता हूं यहां तक लिख दो फिर हम आगे
h bar
psi t tilde plus e I omega naught t s z h bar Hamiltonian e minus I omega naught t s z over h bar psi tilde. Do you understand this? You get this? आधा मिनट देखो इसको दोबारा देख के जस्ट कर लीजिए. I had a Hamiltonian in the left thing. I wanted to transform all my observations into a rotating frame in the hope that I arrest all the time dependencies. I would like to simplify my Hamiltonian. So I start with the motivation, okay, let's move to a rotating frame. Now the rotating frame Hamiltonian is related to the unrotating Hamiltonian through this expression that we have explicitly derived. Now this Hamiltonian is given here, right? H naught plus H1, okay? So my Hamiltonian, my original Hamiltonian is given by omega naught SZ plus omega 1 over 2 Sx cosine omega naught t plus phi p plus Sy sine omega naught t plus phi p. Right? Now I would like to put this Hamiltonian into here and see if I get any simplification. Now one thing I observe, if I look at this term, now this is an operator, this is also an operator, so this sum is also an operator. Now the operators are time dependent. If I want to consider the following. X-axis, y-axis. You know that operators correspond axes of rotation. So all of this is an operator. If my omega naught were 0 and phi p were 0, this term would disappear. Okay? If I had no time dependence, this is 0, this is 0, this will go to 0. Okay? And this will be maximum at Sx. So my axis of rotation will be along Sx. Now with time, what is happening is that the axis of rotation or the operator is changing. Is going from the x direction to the y direction. This is what this operator means. You know that axes of rotation can also be represented on the Bloch sphere. Operators, rotation operators need an axis of rotation which can also be shown on the Bloch sphere. So this axis of rotation is in fact a rotating axis of rotation. Right? So this axis of rotation is actually rotating in the Bloch sphere with an angle with the frequency omega naught. So at time t equals 0, forget about phi p for a minute. This is the initial phase. Forget about this. At time t equals 0, this term is 0. So your axis of rotation is along the x. So your axis of rotation is Sx. At some later time, when omega naught t equals pi by 2, your axis of this becomes 0, your axis of rotation becomes Sy. So your axis of rotation, your operator is actually rotating in the xy plane with the frequency omega naught. Keep up? So, and you already know that if I start off with the axis of rotation Sx, I can rotate this operator, which is just like a similarity transformation on an operator. If I rotate this operator through e raised to the power minus I, omega naught p plus phi p sz over h bar. If I apply this similarity transform on an operator, applying the similarity transform means that I would like to post a pre-multiplication. I would like to apply the similarity transform here and its inverse here. Plus I omega naught p plus phi p sz over h bar. I will recover what I've written in the purple box. This thing is exactly equal to what I've written in the purple box. And you can explicitly prove this as well. Use the theorem that we have, that is S0, 2S0 H bar squared is identity. Break this up, this becomes cosine omega naught t plus phi p identity plus sine omega naught t plus phi p sigma z. Expand this, you will get recover this. You can do it yourself. But here I've given a conceptual proof of why this is correct. This term, these two terms written in the purple box, represent a rotating operator. Right? It's an operator viewed in a different frame. It's just like a quarter wave plate which has a Jones matrix. You rotate the Jones matrix. You post and pre-multiply by a similarity transform. That similarity transform in this case is this rotation operator. It's the rotation operator about the z-axis. And through omega naught p plus phi p, this is the phase. So if you don't believe this conceptual argument, just prove this explicitly. You can expand this term. And you'll find out that it equals what I've written in the purple box. Okay? Hence, my Hamiltonian in the non-rotating frame is actually equal to omega naught Sz plus omega 1 over 2 into this. Right?
एक तरह होता है लेकिन खामोशी किस में होती है? खुद एक खामोशी होती है
जो तसल्ली वाली सुकून वाली एक खामोशी होती है बड़े सवाल छुपे होते हैं ये मुझे दूसरी वाली खामोशी लगती है बेकरारी वाली
देखो मैं
देखो अगर आप एस वाई डालो लेकिन यहाँ पे फेज और है अब मैं यही फेज जहाँ लिखना चाह रहा हूँ जहाँ एस एक्स ही होगा आप देखो अगर इफ टाइम सेट फाइव पी इक्वल जीरो ओके सेट दिस फाइव पी इक्वल जीरो इफ टाइम पी इक्वल जीरो दिस टर्म इज एस एक्स व्हाट इज दिस टर्म एट टाइम पी इक्वल जीरो एस एक्स व्हाट इज दिस टर्म व्हेन ओमेगा नॉट पी इज पाई बाई टू दिस इज ई माइनस आई पाई बाई टू sz over h bar sx e plus I pi by 2 sz over h bar okay so you work this out this turns out to be sy here if you put omega naught t equals pi by 2 5p is 0 our pulse is applied at phase 0 then this term will become 0, this term becomes 1, get s y. ठीक है, तो workout करके देखो. याद रखो कि your pre and post multiplying by an operator. This is not an operation on a state, it's an operation on an operator, which is pre and post multiply. It's a similarity transformation. ये हम पढ़ चुके हैं.
ये operator है कि वहाँ क्या जाता है कि ये box में जो है उसके अंदर हम इस पर दो कैसे करें?
Frequency omega naught. So I would like to put omega naught p plus 5p. Okay. So it's a rotation about the z-axis which is taking your operator from sx to s5. So the rotation is about the sz-axis which is taking sx to s5. Okay. Theek hai na? You should do this as, I cannot do everything in the classroom, right? So you should do this on your own. But I've given you, I think I've tried to give you to the best of my limited capabilities a conceptual argument behind this. Okay? So this is the Hamiltonian in the unrotated frame. Now, I would like to plug this Hamiltonian in here. Can you please tell me what the result will look like? Hilbertian frame equals
this circle
E I omega naught T S Z over H bar into the Hamiltonian, which is this Hamiltonian, right? Omega naught S Z plus omega 1 over 2 E minus I omega naught T plus 5 P Sx T plus I omega naught T plus 5 P Sz H bar, right? Multiplied by this term. Now how do I solve this? I have multiple terms inside these big brackets. I have one term and another term. And each of these terms has to be pre and post multiplied by this operator. So if I take first this term, pre multiply by this and post multiply by this, what is my answer? Bolo? Right. Because Sz commutes with e raised to minus. So this is porous. I can move this Sz anywhere I like because this operator commutes with this operator. If it doesn't, I cannot make this porosity. So I can bring this out, this term will cancel out this term and I will be left with omega naught Sz. But this omega naught Sz minus omega naught Sz goes away. Now I am left with this term. Now I would like to explicitly write this again, EI omega naught T Sz over H bar E minus I omega naught T Sz over H bar. Plus 5 P. So
क्या हो गया?
ये लिखा मैंने फिर अभी E minus I omega naught T plus 5 P Sz over H bar Sx. ठीक है, फिर ये लिखा E plus I omega naught T plus 5 P Sz over H bar, और फिर ये लिखा E minus I omega naught T Sz over H bar. Now if I notice that this E is for minus omega naught T Sz H bar, there's an Sz everywhere. So it's porous. So this cancels out this term. Likewise, this cancels out with this term. And only left with E raised to minus iota phi p Sz over H bar Sx E plus I phi p Sz over H bar. ठीक है? Now can you please tell me what you expect the result of this transformation to be? I have an Sx operator. It is being pre and post multiplied. This is a rotation operator, right? This is also a rotation operator. These two operators are inverses of one another. So this operation is a similarity transformation. It is rotating this operator. The rotation is through Sz, is about Sz and through an angle phi p. So what should my result be? Sx, shabash, cosine of phi p plus Sy sine of phi p. So this is my new Hamiltonian, independent of time. The Hamiltonian in the rotating frame, and with the help of this Hamiltonian, I can find out the new quantum state quite easily. Because now I have moved to a rotating frame. I have arrested the time dependence. And when I draw this trajectory, you will appreciate what I've done more vividly, because I'm going to draw a diagram to actually show you what's going on here. Mathematically, what we've done, we started with the Hamiltonian. This is our Hamiltonian, with a complicated H1 which looks like this. I want you to transform to a rotating frame so that I can eliminate all the time dependencies in the Hamiltonian. Okay? And I've been successful in doing this. Here my Hamiltonian is independent of time. Notice that the original Hamiltonian, I had explicit time dependence, right? But I want you to play a trick. I want you to move with the state with the same frequency, omega naught, so that I see a Hamiltonian, an effective Hamiltonian in a rotating frame that is not rotating. Okay, that's what I've been successful in achieving. Now, if this is my Hamiltonian, I can easily find what the new quantum state is going to be. Is this thing, Sx cosine phi p plus Sy sine phi p, right, t over h bar. So this is my new state. Let me write this more elegantly. This is looking extremely ugly. Quantum state after time t is given by E minus iota H in the rotating frame, because I would like to work in the rotating frame now. Initial state, which is alpha. This state is unchanged in the rotating or the unrotating frame because it is on the pole. I get E minus I Sx cosine phi b plus Sy sine phi b T over H bar acting on alpha. I can easily find out what the new state is going to be. Now I am doing a rotation about an axis which is in the equatorial plane at a phase phi p with respect to the x-axis. And this is my Bloch sphere. This is my x-axis or the sx-axis, this is my sy-axis. Then my axis of rotation is determined by this operator, right? So my axis of rotation is now lying at an angle phi p, right, with respect to the x-axis. So by choosing the pulse of the phase of the pulse, by choosing the phase of the pulse, of course, I also have an omega 1 over 2. I keep on forgetting that. By choosing the phase of the pulse, I can choose my axis of rotation. Okay? If phi p is 0, then my axis of rotation is along Sx, because this term goes to 0. Then I'm doing a rotation about the x-axis. I started off with the state at alpha. I'm doing a rotation about the x-axis. So my new state will have a trajectory like this, right? Because I'm doing a rotation about the x-axis. So this is my x-axis, this is my state, I go like this. So if the phase of my pulse which I'm controlling from the computer is 0 degrees, I'm doing a rotation about the x-axis. And my new state, psi t, is simply going to be cosine, and you should be able to do this off your head now. It should be equal to cosine omega 1 over 2 t. In fact, omega 1 over 4 t, because this is omega 1 over 2 divided by 2 alpha plus go here. Plus sine omega 1 t over 4. And what's the azimuthal angle here? It's 3 pi by 4. Right? It's e raised to the I, 3 pi by 4. You know that any point on the Bloch sphere is given by cosine theta by 2 alpha plus sine theta by 2 pi phi theta, right? When theta is the angle of the four latitude and phi is the azimuthal angle. So by looking at this general form, I can write out what the new state is going to be. If the phase of my pulse is 90 degrees, then what axis I'm rotating about? The y-axis. Because then this goes to zero, then my axis of rotation is actually this axis. So I can apply rotation about the x-axis, I can apply rotation about the y-axis, just by changing the phase of the pulse, which is adjustable from the computer. Last thing before we break, if phi p is pi by 2, then my state psi t is going to be equal to e minus I omega 1 over 2 s y, right, t over h bar acting on alpha, right? This is the rotation about the s y axis through an angle omega 1 t over 2, right? So I rotate about this axis through a certain angle. If I adjust, if omega 1 t is, if omega 1 over 2 t is pi over 2, then I will land here. Right? If omega 1 over t divided by 2 is equal to 90 degrees, then my angle of rotation is 90 degrees. SME? Okay, because I can put a 2 here, I can put a 4 here. So I will get this here, alpha plus beta, which is really cosine of 45 degrees. So if I have this condition, that is my, what is t now? T is the pulse time. If my pulse time is adjusted such that omega 1 multiplied by the pulse time divided by 2 is 90 degrees, I do a 90 degrees rotation, I am doing a pi by 2 pulse. I can also do a pi pulse. Just by changing the timing of my pulse, how long is the pulse, I can do a 90 degree rotation, a 180 degree rotation, a 45 degree rotation. All of this Bloch sphere is under my control now. I can go to any point I like on the Bloch sphere, given an initial state, just by changing the phase of my pulse that is adjustable from the computer and the timing of the pulse and of course the strength of the field that I'm applying. All right. So after, let's meet at 10 minutes to 7. Let's meet positively at 10 minutes to 7 so that we can wrap up. I'm going to wrap up the discussion. What's happening in an NMR experiment? I have constant field always on B naught Z, which means that the spins are always seen in the Hamiltonian H naught given by omega naught SZ. Under the action of this Hamiltonian, the spins will recess. Omega naught is minus gamma B naught. Generally of the order of megahertz. Now if this is the zero of my time, I turn on a pulse which is along the x-axis. But the pulse has some phase. So it's a sinusoidal pulse that is turned on at zero. It has some initial phase, right? This is some t naught, which means it has a phase phi t equals omega naught e naught. So this is our initial phase of the pulse. You can start this pulse anywhere. It can start here, 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 and that is captured in the phase of the pulse. So you can start with a cosine function or a sine function or anything in between. This is controllable by the computer. The frequency of this pulse is omega naught, right? It's the same as this frequency. So you are putting a pulse such that your applied pulse is in resonance with the natural frequency of the system. Okay. The amplitude of this field is V1. This is V1. Right? And this function is V1 is a function of time, right? And is pointing along the x direction. And we know that the Hamiltonian corresponding to this function is given by omega 1 over 2 Sx cosine omega naught t plus phi t plus Sy sine omega naught t plus phi t. However, if you would like to use these Hamiltonians as an exponentiate these Hamiltonians, finding the new state will be arduous, will be very difficult. Therefore, we moved to a rotating frame. In the rotating frame, the Hamiltonian turned out to be extremely simple. It just turned out to be omega 1 over 2 Sx cosine of the phase phi t plus Sy the phase sine of the phase. The Hamiltonian turned out to be extremely convenient and it had no time dependence. Now if we look at the Bloch sphere picture, if we start with the state being the spin being in the state cat beta, and we apply this pulse such that we start by a sine pulse, which means that our phase phi t is 90 degrees. At time 0, the phase of this function is 90 degrees. So we start out with a sine pulse. Our axis of rotation becomes Sy. Okay? So this is our axis of rotation. And this is our initial state. So the rotation will take place about this axis. This is my axis of rotation, this is my initial state. So my state will tend to move under the action of this rotation towards the equatorial plane, right? So it will have this trajectory, it will move towards the equatorial plane. If I adjust this time period, Tp, appropriately, I can make this quantum state to end up here, or here, or here, or on the equatorial plane. I can even make it go anywhere in the southern hemisphere. I have to adjust Tp appropriately. Because my operation now is E minus iota omega 1 over 2 Sy E over h bar. So now you know that the angle of rotation is omega 1 E over 2. My new state is ket E, so this is ket alpha. So my new state is ket alpha cosine of omega 1 T over 4 plus sine omega 1 T over 4 ket beta. Right? So I know my rotation operator. I can explicitly find out, even geometrically, where my final state is going to be. If I adjust my time Tp of the pulse, the duration of this pulse and the height of this pulse, V1, such that omega 1 t is of the proper magnitude, I can finish my pulse at the equatorial plane, anywhere in the northern hemisphere or in the southern hemisphere. I can apply a 90 degree pulse, a 180 degree pulse, anything. If I adjust the phase, I can apply a rotation about the Sx axis, about the Sy axis. In fact, all of these axes are now at my disposal. I can choose any axis that I like. I can perform a rotation on any axis that I choose. Alright? Now, this is the picture of the trajectory in the rotating frame, which means that I'm rotating with the frequency omega naught. Now, can you extrapolate, or can you guess what the picture of this trajectory will look like in the lab frame? Not the operator, the how will the state change? Beautiful. It's just going to look like a spiral. So this is the picture of the state in the rotating frame. I'm moving with a frequency omega naught. Right? So when I'm moving with a frequency omega, I don't see any spiral motion. I don't see any precession. However, if I look at this at the same operation in the lab frame, what I observe is that my quantum state that starts off here as ket alpha is actually going around, is precessing with a frequency omega naught. But it's also coming down at the same time. So it's going around, coming down here. It's moving towards the equatorial plane under the action of the rotation operator, but it's constantly in a state of precession with the frequency omega naught. Here I don't see this precession because I'm moving with the state at a frequency omega naught. However, if I transport back to the lab frame, I go back to my original frame, the quantum state must actually be precessing with the frequency omega naught. Therefore, this state is actually precessing the frequency omega naught, right? Under the action of the SZ Hamiltonian. And it's also coming down towards the equatorial plane under the action of this rotation operator. And will it make, how many cycles, how many turns on the spiral will it make before it comes towards the equatorial plane? Of the order of thousands, because of the omega naught frequency is extremely high. So it makes many more cycles, many more windings before it comes back towards the equatorial. So it's precessing with the frequency omega naught, but it's coming down with the frequency omega 1 over 2, which is of the order of kilohertz. This motion is called precession, and this motion is generally called nutation. So this is what is happening in the lab frame, in the rotating frame. This is easier to digest, easier to work out calculationally, and this is what is actually happening in the lab frame. Now let's draw a master diagram of the NMR apparatus. Coil. Right, this is an X coil, right? It's oriented along the X direction. There's a capacitor here so that I can make it resonant with any frequency I like. If this is a 1 Tesla field, I know that I have to be resonant at 42 MHz. I have to put in a pulse at 42 MHz. Now I have a PC that creates a pulse. I tell it what PP do I need, I tell it what B1 do I need, because B1 is controlling omega 1. I tell it the phase of this pulse. I put it inside the computer program. This digital waveform goes to a digital to analog converter. It's converted to a real current, right? An analog current. This is then amplified, because this is generally a weak signal, you want to boost it up. Now this goes through a device, and tell you what this device is. Into the resonance circuit, right? So when I would like to apply a pulse, which means I would like to rotate the spins, because if my spins remain in the alpha or beta state, they will not give me a signal. I need to get into the equatorial plane to get signal, because My coils are in the XY plane and they are picking up an EMF. I need to get my spins into the equatorial plane. So I need to apply a pulse. If my spins are in the alpha beta state, I need to get them into the equatorial plane. So I need to apply a pulse, a 90 degree pulse perhaps. So I apply this pulse with these parameters. I can do, for example, a 90 degree rotation. Now when initially my spins, say, were in the cat alpha state, I do a 90 degree rotation, I get the cat alpha plus cat beta state. In the Bloch sphere picture, initially I am here. This is before the pulse. After the pulse, I am here. Here, right? Now I am precessing with the frequency omega naught. Now I use this coil to pick up the signal. What this coil is now picking up is d by dt of expectation value of Sx, as we already discussed. It's picking up the time dependent, the derivative of the expectation value of Sx. Now the same coil is being used as a transmitter. It's transmitting a signal to the spins, a classical signal to the spin, that frequency omega naught, which is resonant with the natural frequency of the system. So this antenna or coil is transmitting a signal. Now you want to turn off the transmission circuit and you would like to use the same antenna to receive a signal, and that signal is the time derivative of Sx. Okay, so now the signal, previously I was transmitting a signal Tx and it was transmitted through this coil, through this antenna. Now when the pulse is turned off, my computer tells this device to change direction. This device acts like a valve. The transmitted signal goes here, but the received signal goes here. Okay? So this device is called a duplexer. So when the transmission circuit is off, I have excited the spins, they are in the equatorial plane and they are processing the frequency omega naught. I want to pick up a signal. An EMF is generated inside the same coil, which has been tuned to the proper frequency, so the power that it picks up is also very large. So it picks up some power, and now this is of course a sinusoidal signal with the frequency omega naught. Right? Look at the last lecture, last legs of the previous lecture. So now this received signal comes in through the coil, goes through this duplexer into the received circuit. Now it is amplified again through a low noise amplifier. Because this is an extremely small signal of the order of microvolts. So it has to be amplified without amplifying the noise. It's called a low noise amplifier or a preamplifier. This then goes into some filters. I'm giving you a very simplistic explanation so that I can pick up the correct frequency. It then goes into an analog to digital converter, which digitizes the signal. Here you have a sinusoidal signal of the frequency omega naught. Okay, which is coming from the precession, and we proved this in the previous class. That is, the EMF is proportional to the time derivative of the expectation value of Sx. Now this signal is then digitized. It's sampled, digitized, and then it goes into the computer, and the computer runs a Fourier transform algorithm. This is a time domain signal. It computes the Fourier transform and you're left with a signal, a spectrum, which is called a spectrum at the frequency omega naught. This is called an NMR spectrum. Let me show you a few examples just to wrap up the discussion. I promise, just 2 minutes. न्यूज की म्यूटेशन अगली दफा करूंगा। ये एक और इंटरेस्टिंग एप्लीकेशन और एक सो एथेनॉल और एल्कोहल CH3CH2OH। नाउ दीज प्रोटॉन्स दीज मेथिलीन प्रोटॉन्स गिव यू अ सर्टेन सिग्नल व्हिच इज हियर। These protons give you a certain signal which is here. Now, even though all six of them are protons, forget about this hydroxyl protons, all five of these are protons and they have a frequency, a Lama frequency of 42 megahertz in a field of 1 Tesla, yet they occur at different frequencies in the spectrum. And that is because the frequency changes by depending upon the local environment of the spin. So these spins, these three spins are in a different local environment than these spins, because these spins are two bond lengths away from a hydroxyl group and this is an electronegative element. So these protons see a different electronic environment than these protons. So hence these three protons will have a different, slightly different Lamo frequency from these protons. This is called chemical shift. So depending upon where the spin is inside the molecule, the Lama frequency may slightly change. So this is a spectrum of ethanol. And you can see that these lines are further split because each spin is coupled to other spins. But we're not going to talk about this in this course. So this is a spectrum of ethanol. Of course, you can also look at carbon 13 nuclei. If you have ethanol, the abundant element is carbon, isotope is carbon 12, but carbon 13 is 1% of all the all the atoms who belong to carbon 13. So those are spin half nuclei. You can also do a carbon 13 spectrum. And the gyromagnetic ratio of carbon 13 is 1/4 that of the proton. So these carbon lines will appear at different frequencies. And depending upon which carbon we're talking about, whether we're talking about the methylene carbon or the methylene or the methyl carbon, there will be different frequencies. So this is the NMR of muscle water. Now, not only does the position of the peak change depending upon the environment, the width of this peak also changes. So if you have healthy tissue and you do an MRI, the width of that peak will be different from a cancerous tissue or a malignant tissue. The peaks from water inside blood will have a different width and a different shape from water peaks inside, say, cerebrospinal fluid or gray matter. So depending upon the environment, the width of the peak also changes. And the width is determined by the relaxation. Because any spin that is recessing in the XY plane, it has to move back to its ground state. Alright, I think we should end here. We'll look at one more example of muon spin rotation and that will just take 10 minutes. I'm going to upload a homework today, which will be due next Wednesday. On Tuesday, we're going to have a tutorial with lots of questions. And the following Monday, we're going to have a quiz. We're going to have 4 to 5 quizzes in total. So thank you for your attention and for your patience.